As we continue our holy conversation on Galatians, a new study will begin on September 13th from the book The Pursuit of Holiness by Jerry Bridges. Order your copy soon to begin reading ahead of the 13th. Do you feel called to lift up the needs of the people of God in prayer with others? Join us at our weekly prayer meeting on Fridays at 5 p.m. There will be a council meeting next Sunday at 11:30 following fellowship. All are welcome to attend. Are there any other announcements for the good of the church? Yes, Art.
I just wanted to announce today is 2 years that Pastor Julia has been with us here at Bradford Woods Community Church. And yeah, it's an exciting day. And right after service today, we're going to have a little special celebration. But I just wanted to mention that today because it is an important day for the church. And we just feel so blessed and happy to have you here, Pastor Julia.
Call to worship. God moves among us.
We welcome your presence, Lord, no matter by what means you arrive.
Reach out your hand, and I shall always be with you.
We reach out you, Jesus, and trust that you are present when we fear or ache.
Your presence, O Lord, calms the seas as it calms our hearts.
May we rest assured that you are ever present with us, calming our worries as you love our anxieties into softness.
Now, if you would stand in vocal worship for our opening hymn, It Is Well With My Soul.
Oh,
many names, you command us to come to you, yet we are doubtful of our abilities to make the journey. We are so uncertain of our steps, yet we long to have the faith in ourselves that you have in us. Be with us and embolden us through faith to rise as we are called to walk with you and walk alongside those who need companionship. Show us how to be children of God who can set skepticism down and take up the mantle of faithful presence. Amen.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Psalms. I am reading from the Living Bible, so you can only follow along in your Bible. I am listening carefully to all the Lord is saying, for he speaks peace to his people, his saints, if they will only stop their sinning. Surely his salvation is near to those who reverence him. Our land will be filled with his glory. Mercy and truth have met together. Grim justice and peace have kissed. Truth rises from the earth, and righteous smiles down from heaven. Yes, the Lord pours down his blessings on the land, and he yields its bountiful crops. Justice goes before him to make a pathway for his steps. This is the word of the Lord.
In a similar fashion as last week, we have our next hymn as Walking on Water to the tune of Walking on Sunshine from Katrina and the Waves. These lyrics were just adjusted. We're not, you know, trying to sell this as a new song, but if you would stand.
can I just say too?
Oh yeah.
What a gift that she comes up with words for these songs that go with the service, right? And what we're teaching today. So I just love that, Bree. Thank you for you and sharing your gift with us. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Send out a whoop or an amen.
out of their boats, aren't you? How about that? Wow. Let's get out of that boat of sinfulness, right? And turn to the Lord in vulnerability as we go to Him with a spirit of metanoia, of transformation. Join me. God, our gentle parent, bring calm to the storms that batter us and blow us off course. Forgive us in times when we are afraid. Remind us the importance of relying on you, who help us walk through our lives as whole and holy children, who recognize that your love unites us, believes us, and carries us forward to face miraculous challenges in a complex world. Help us to see through the clutter we create in our daily existence in order to focus on what is most important: love, compassion, faith, and connection. God forgives our fear-filled thoughts and actions. Even when we doubt, God is with us, immediately taking our hand when we falter. God walks beside us, through us, and with us in all that we do. Thanks be to God for grace, mercy, and forgiveness that are new each day. Amen? Now we come to a time where we lift up the needs of each other and those whom we love. And you'll notice, I want to point out on the back of your bulletin, this is a prayer that I would ask if you could pray this week for the people of Maui. This comes from a colleague of mine in the United Church of Christ, one of our conference ministers that oversees that area. And we have lost some churches, the pastors' homes, and certainly lives. So if you can keep that in your mind and hearts through the week, really appreciate it. So I'll get us started, and then I'm just going to have you shout out any prayer requests that the Lord places on your mind or heart. Let us pray. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise. And Lord, even in the midst of storms, we try. We try to make sure to keep praising you, but it's hard. It is hard to find that it is well with our souls. It's challenging in the midst of the storm to not focus on the waves that are tormenting us. But Lord, your promise is that you are with us. And we thank you, O God. We thank you for your holy presence in this place. We thank you for your holy presence that shows up in every space that we are in at all times. Help us be mindful, O God. Help us to draw near to you as we lift up all those things that you place on our hearts and minds.
My son-in-law, Paul Pomerleau,
my in-laws, the Carsons, because they transitioned St. Barnabas from assisted living to convalescent care. My college friend Carmen, who is from an ICU, in one hospital to an ICU.
My dad and his siblings, my grandmother passed in October, but we were finally able to put her to rest this weekend. So keep them in your prayers.
Lord, I am especially filled with joy, for not only can't believe it's been 2 years, but celebrating a wonderful day today with these, my church family. And also, Lord, what a wonderful joy to celebrate today's anniversary, to get to serve with my sister Missy. Thanks be to God that she is here today. And up here serving with me, Lord. I just thank you, Lord, for your healing hand upon your people, for the way in which you protect us, guide us, in ways we aren't even aware. And Lord, we know that as we have lifted up the prayers that we have spoken and those that we still hold deep within our hearts, that you are already participating in all those spaces. And we thank you, Lord. And as you have taught us, we lift up to you now a prayer in one voice, in one body, the prayer that you, Lord Jesus, taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You would stand in vocal worship for our next hymn, Love Lifted Me.
verses 25 to 33. About 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus came to them, walking on the water. They screamed in terror, for they thought he was a ghost. But Jesus immediately spoke to them, reassuring them. "Don't be afraid," he said. Then Peter called to him, "Sir, if it is really you, tell me to come over to you, walking on the water." "All right," the Lord said, "come along." So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he looked around at the high waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Instantly, Jesus reached out his hand and rescued him. "Oh, man of little faith," Jesus said, "why did you doubt me?" And when they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped. The others sat there awestruck. "Oh, you really are the Son of God," they explained. Hear the word of the Lord.
The kids can come up if they'd like. Good morning. How are you guys all doing today?
Good.
Enjoying the summer still?
Yeah.
Yeah. Keep doing it. There's not that much left. About a week, huh? Mm-hmm. It's an exciting time, too. You all go back to school. I'd like to play a game with you guys today. Are you up for that?
Yeah.
Okay. It involves this bucket of water here. And the game is called Sink or Float. Okay? And I have some items here, and you guys have to decide if you think they'll sink or float. So this is a leaf. What do you think?
Float.
Float? Float? Everybody's float? Will you drop that in and see if you're right? What does it do? It's floating. You guys are correct. You guys are smart. All right. There's something else. You know what that is? It's a rock. A big, heavy rock. Sink or float?
Sink.
Everybody says sink. You get to drop that in. Oh, you did that nice thing and you didn't splash that. You're right again. A pencil.
Float.
Float. Oh, it took a dive, didn't it? But it came back up. Okay, you guys are 3 for 3. How about a golf ball?
Sink.
Sink. Okay. And there it goes down to the bottom. As all our golfers know, if they hit the water jump, you don't get your ball back. All right, here's one more. It's a lemon. Sink or float. It's here. What? Feel it, how heavy it is. Pass it along. Sink? What do you think? Float? Uh-oh, we got difference of opinions. Here we go. Go ahead. Drop it in. What does it do? It floats. Yes, the lemon floats. Now, if we would tie your hands and feet together and throw you in the water, what would happen? Sink or float? You're not swimming. You would sink. We'd all sink. If you don't swim, you sink. And that's what happened to Peter, because the boat was out in the middle of water, and he jumped in, and he started walking on water. First, Jesus was walking on water. And you know why Jesus could walk on water? He was filled with the Holy Spirit. He had more faith and more strength in God than anything else. And Peter initially did, because what faith is, you guys can hold that. It's just a muscle. Faith is like a muscle. And when you lift weights for your muscles and you get strong and tight, you get more and more and more faith. And then you could lift something heavier. You got it? That would sink. And that's what happened to Peter. Peter had some faith,
But then he got out, and I don't even know if you guys can hold this one. Mac, you want to try?
Yeah.
You got it? Don't drop it on your toes. Okay. But that's what happens all along. We start at a low rate of faith, and we lift, and we get stronger and stronger. And by studying the Bible and praying and going different things, our faith gets stronger, and we're able to face bigger and better things. Where Peter had faith, but most of it just withered away when he started seeing the waves crashing, and he got scared. And he took his focus off God, and he just wasn't strong enough to lift the big weights. And so that's where he was at. So will you guys pray with me today?
Dear Lord,
thank you
for giving us
the many ways
to strengthen our faith
in you.
May we constantly strive
to be strong.
Amen.
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 Okay. Thank you, guys.
Started. Welcome. I believe I didn't get to come say hello yet. I'm not going to embarrass you. I don't mean to embarrass you. I just want to welcome you. You're the reason she's wonderful. So we thank you. Okay. I'm Pastor Julia DeFury, and this is one of my favorite topics. I get really excited. Because there's two of my favorite topics to teach on. The reason being is because they are the go-to tools in evil's tool shed. One, the first one that's most commonly used, anybody guess? Pride. The second one is fear. Those two things can really mess with not only a person's individual life, but a church. So that's our topic today, fear and anxiety. If you look at the title, if you want to walk on water, you got to do what?
Get on that boat.
That's right. So that's what we're talking about today. Was that a sneeze? God bless you. A little boy is afraid of the dark. One night, his mother tells him to go out to the back porch and bring her the broom. The little boy turns to his mother and says, "Mama, I don't want to go out there. It's dark." The mother smiles reassuringly at her son. "You don't have to be afraid of the dark," she explains. "Jesus is out there. He'll look after you and protect you." The little boy looks at his mother real hard and asks, "Are you sure he's out there?" "Yes. I'm sure. He's everywhere, and he is always ready to help you when you need him," she says. Then the little boy, he thinks about that for a minute, and then goes to the back door, cracks it a little, peering out into the darkness. He calls,
anxiety or anxiety. They're not the same thing. But all of us have experienced it at some point or another, in little ways maybe, or even big immobilizing ways. Sometimes so much that it stops us from getting out of our boat. In our gospel text, the apostles were experiencing fear and anxiety for hours before Jesus shows up on the scene. And poor Jesus. We trace these previous steps. Gets rejected by his hometown, his cousin who he loves dearly is murdered. The man just wants to have some time to process things and pray, and then come thousands of people that won't leave him alone. He sees their need, he feeds them. Then finally, he sets some boundaries. For why? The purpose of self-care and prayer. He sends the apostles onto a boat to head to the other side because the mission was going to continue. And what does he do? He's the one that takes care of closing up the church, sends people on their way. It's time now for him to have time with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And by the way, the lake that we're talking about in this is called the lake. It's Galilee, Gennesaret. You'll hear different terms in Scripture. It's a lake kind of similar to Lake Erie. The difference is that this lake, the weather on the Sea of Galilee, why they called it a sea, I don't remember. I learned that once, but it's a lake, okay? But the weather can turn at a dime. It'll be sunny, beautiful, calm. You're in your boat, it's all good. All of a sudden, if you've seen images on the news of Lake Erie with those huge waves crashing, that's what Lake Galilee can turn into. Now, in our text, there are certain things you're not going to know because of the English translation. But so that you're aware, when they started off, it said it was evening. It was 6 p.m., roughly, when they started off. The text in the Greek for when Jesus showed up is the fourth hour, which is, just to keep it simple, it was 4 a.m., okay? Now, I know some, you may have heard in the Living Bible, I think it said, did it say 6 p.m. or something? Yeah, that's not right. That's where we mess up a little bit in translations. It was actually 4 a.m. So, you know, you've got them heading out 6 p.m. Jesus showing up at 4 a.m. How many hours is that? Stuck in a storm. And the word for the waves in the Greek actually means torment. So the boat was being tormented by the waves, okay? So that we understand that a little bit. So imagine hours of fighting the waves. You're tired, and they were experienced. My goodness, they're fishermen. They weren't new at dealing with that lake. But that's a long time of battling waves that they know could kill them. So you're tired. The sun's not up yet, and you see a figure of a man coming out on the water towards you. And Jesus says, "Do not be afraid. It is I," is what our English tells us. Now, it's the opinion of many scholars that Jesus is connecting himself with the identity of I am. Okay? We don't get that out of that English, so it's important to note that. Which the apostles would understand because they would know the Old Testament identity of God, that God gave God's self. Notice Jesus didn't say, hey, don't be afraid, it's me, Jesus. He didn't say that, did he? He said, it was I. What he was saying simply is, do not fear, I am. Now when they heard that speaks. So Peter wasn't as crazy as we think when he offered to get out of the boat. He hears that and he's like, you probably got some major God bumps, because I do when I think about it. Understanding what Jesus was communicating, Peter asked to be commanded to come to him. Because if Jesus is truly claiming in this moment to be I am, then he would be able to command the natural world as it was known in the Old Testament. Think of the Old Testament. What happens? Seas part. Pillars of fire. Jesus has that divine connection to I am. Well, certainly, I'm going to be able to walk on water if he commands me to. Peter, though afraid and unsure, gets out of the boat. Looking at Jesus, begins walking to him, doesn't he? Now, you ever experienced something that seems too amazing to believe? Anybody? You're like, is this really happening? Only one of you? Come on. Okay. Like, you have to pause and pinch yourself because it's so hard to believe. This is when these popcorns, I'll call them, of doubt, start going off in your mind. Peter takes his eyes off Jesus and looks at the waves. That's when he begins to sink. Jesus grabs him, they climb up in the boat, and what happens? The water suddenly becomes still. Then, their eyes are open. All of them on the boat are open. The great I am is in their midst. There are many things I love about this good news. So much it teaches us. Besides the importance of self-care that Jesus exhibits, what does Jesus teach us to do before the storm hits? Pray. Jesus prays before the storm. That's an important thing for us to learn. Because if we are praying unceasingly, like the word teaches, we're going to be more prepared for those storms. Yes? Preparation before the storm is key to walking through the storm. But it's Jesus, so of course he can handle the storm. That's kind of what we think about. That's my point. If Jesus prays, how much more important for us is it to pray? If Jesus prays, to prepare? But we, like the apostles, will experience times when storms hit out of nowhere. Missy had one of those, right? Did you know you were going to fall down the stairs? Nope. Her whole life was changed. Sometimes life hits us like that, doesn't it? We don't see something that's going to come, and all of a sudden tragedy hits. The waves of life come crashing in, and getting out of the boat is not a choice that we want to make. It's safer to stay in the boat where the waves can't get to us. The problem, however, is by staying in the boat, who we are will remain who we will be, including the level of faith. When fear immobilizes us, evil wins because our faith will never grow enough to understand the power of Christ that can defeat it. A pastor named Ernest Campbell once said, "The reason that we seem to lack faith in our time is that we are not doing anything that requires it." We like to stay safe in the boats. With faith comes risk. It isn't until you venture into the unknown that you will find what's been known for all time. The holy, uncreated one who can speak truth into that which makes us afraid. Jesus knows what we are feeling and asks us to keep looking at him, to keep our eyes on him, so that we won't be taken over by the crashing waves. Because the truth is, Jesus is more powerful than the fear or the waves. Finally, the beautiful lesson in this gospel is what happens for others because of one brave enough to stand and face the storm in faith, calling on and relying on the voice of truth that speaks within us, calling us to walk even if we are afraid to walk. Now this is where it gets to be church. Peter was the only one who saw and was getting it. Because of his faith, even though it faltered, it made an impact on the others in the boat, giving them the ability to now also see Christ for who he was, and they finally proclaim who he is. Perhaps whatever God calls us to do or be, maybe one of us will stand up and step out of the boat to help us all walk in a new way of seeing. Perhaps. But it's hard. And have you ever noticed whenever the Bible says, do not be afraid, a call often follows? A call to discipleship. And that in itself can be scary. Commitment to God, church, a call. That can be scary. Making a covenant, that can be scary. Having faith in and of itself, it can be scary. Because if we believe, what will God call us to? What will God ask of us? That can be scary. It's better just to stay in the boat. We're safe there. But actually, no, it isn't better. We can't stay in the boat forever unless we want to languish. Then, okay. Certainly we all have that choice that we can make. But I would hope we all want to grow and flourish in our faith, right?
Yes.
To grow the capacity to consider, to grow the capacity to consider stepping out of the boat. Or we wouldn't be here. And did you hear that? I'm not saying this pastor doesn't expect you to jump out of your boat.
But I am asking to pray about developing the capacity to think about stepping out of your boat. Because you won't be doing it alone. Only you know what your boat is, what your safety is, what your comfortable place is. Only you know what waves are happening in your lives. Only you know what causes you fear. And all I can do is to reassure you that you too can walk on the crashing waves with Jesus. But first, you have to get out of the boat. And I can promise you that He is there with you, but only you can choose to keep your eyes on Him. Imagine, if you will. Imagine if all of us, if we as church can keep our eyes on Jesus all the time, in all things, stepping out of the boat into whatever we are afraid of. And if we can just keep our eyes on Jesus, we will walk with Him, knowing He has us. And whatever we are called to accomplish together, even if we are afraid, we can do it afraid. And for His glory, together, encouraging each other to keep our eyes on Him. Doing this will accomplish whatever He calls us to. For God's glory, may it be so. Amen.
Surrounded by the sound of a thousand warriors shaking in to a time for Thanksgiving of our tithes and offerings. Certainly we are grateful for all those who support the ministry of this church. And soon we're going to have a cool little way for those of you online and even people from here to give digitally, so it's a little easier for the giving, right? So that's exciting. And in case you're not aware, we don't do the come forward offering time. We just keep the basket in the back. So if the Lord puts on your heart to donate to this church, you just toss it in because it's between you and the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
The gifts of faith come to us in many ways, and the miracles we witness are not always so obvious. May the manifestation of God's great abundance in our lives inspire us to generosity in as many ways as we see God's love unfurl. Thank you for giving us grateful hearts and a spirit of generosity for the flourishing of your realm. Amen. Let us rise, bow our heads, and pray for God's blessing. May God bless you with fearless strength when storms arise. May you see and experience the hand of Jesus that reaches out to you. And may the Holy Spirit assist you to walk hand in hand with the Holy One in the days ahead. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Just stay standing for our choral benediction. We're going to take one baby step out of the boat, and we're going to do this without the piano. When I came here and first did this choral benediction with you guys, I was so impressed with how well we all knew this together. So I'll get us started, but then if we all would join in together, singing our choral benediction.
May the Lord God guide us in love and grant us peace.
Thank you.